So if you have your Bibles, I want you to go ahead and turn to 1 Corinthians. We're going to begin in verse 10. It's not up on the screen this morning, so I hope you have the text in front of you, that we can soak in the Word of God and what it has to say to us this morning. So again, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We're going to be starting in verse 10, and this is what the Word of God says to our church this morning. Paul writes, "I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and same judgment. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there is quarreling among you, my brothers. What I mean is that each one of you says, 'I follow Paul,' or 'I follow Apollos,' or 'I follow Cephas,' or 'I follow Christ.' Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one may say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else, for Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. And not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Father God, we come to you this morning with such a weighty text. We have already begged and pleaded that you would allow your Spirit to fall in this place. God, that is our desire. We have cried out, change us from the inside out. Make us more like Jesus. Allow your word to sink into our hearts and transform our lives, that when we leave here, no one can say, or no one can doubt, that we have been in the presence of our God. It's in his name we pray. Amen. So this morning we've been, or rather I should say, so for the past few weeks we've been walking through a family series. And we've talked about teaching and training and modeling Christ to our children and to others as well. And so that we can see Christ growing in them and them growing in Christ. And today what we're going to do is kind of take a sidestep away from our family series, specifically to address a family issue. And here's what I mean to say is that I want to talk about something that has come up recently that has potential to be an issue for Clough if it's not addressed. But if it's addressed, as we're going to take the time to do so today, I believe it has the ability to bring about greater unity in our church family and better ability to reach the people that God wants us to reach with the gospel. I think that is absolutely important, that there be unity and that there be a passion and a togetherness in us going out to reach people with the gospel of Christ. And I want you to hear this, because there's no mistake in Scripture that God considers the unity of his church absolutely paramount to the mission of the church. Here's what Jesus says in John 17 as he prayed for future believers and for the future church. And listen, that is us. Jesus is praying for us, and this is what he prays. He says, "I do not ask for these only," that meaning the disciples, because he just finished praying for the disciples that were with him, "but also for those who will believe in me through their word." That's us. And he prays this, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also be in us. Why? So that the world may believe that you have sent me. Somehow, Jesus was praying and telling us that in us being one, in our church having unity, that people would be brought to Christ because of our togetherness, that the world would look at us, what we have here as the family of God. We've been preaching, we are a family of families, our oneness, and would want what Jesus has. They would somehow believe the gospel better because of how we live out the gospel as a church, and specifically in our unity. So unity is absolutely paramount to the mission of God advancing in his church. So today's going to be a little bit different in a sense, but I really want you to think of this sermon as more of a family meeting. We've been doing this family series, and you know, here's the deal. When you have an issue in the family, you call together the family and you have a family meeting. You say, we're going to talk about these things. And today we're going to talk and cover some deeper theological ground along the way. And what I want to say to you from the onset is I hope to explain it clearly, concisely, simply. I don't want you to go away wondering, you know, what it is we're talking about. So we're going to cover some things in some detail. And so I just want to prepare you for that. Listen, church family, if you do have a child, fifth grade and under, I want you to know that we extended children's church up through fifth grade just for this very reason. We don't want them to get lost. And so if you do have a child, one of you might be able to run them down at this time. That is available for you, and you can pick them up there after service. But that being said, if you're a guest this morning, I want you to know that while we're having this family discussion, we're truly glad that you're here this morning. I believe that we have a really awesome church family. You know, Larry kind of made the joke that we recommend ourselves highly at the very beginning of church. And here's what we mean. We just like the way God's moving in our church. We're excited about what God is doing in this church. We would love for you to be a part of what God is doing in this church. And that's what he means. It's not haughty. It's not proud. It's just happy you're here. And we're happy that God is moving in this place. So here's what we want you to know. We're glad you're here for joining us for worship this morning. More than that, we want you to know that the hope we have is absolutely in Christ, and it's hope that we hope you hear about even as we talk about these family things this morning. We want you to know that the power of the gospel is power that is life transforming. That's what we sang about this morning. It transformed my life, and it can transform your life as well as you trust Jesus as your Savior and begin to have a relationship with God. We are glad you're here. And with all of that said, we're going to dive right in to the deep end. So today I want to begin by saying that we must prioritize unity as a church family. We just read Paul's launching into his letter to the Corinthian church, and he puts the priority of unity almost at the beginning of the letter. He puts it on the table right away. He doesn't want there to be an issue. He doesn't want them to get sidetracked. He begins with the, hey, how are you? And he dives right into unity because that is paramount to Paul. He actually begins in verse 10 and he says this, that I appeal to you brothers. He says, I'm appealing to the church as brothers and sisters in Christ. The King James uses the word beseeched. He says, I beseech you, brothers in Christ. Some translation also use the word exhort. Here's what you're wanting to get, no matter what translation that you're using, is that this is a big word. See, in the Greek, the word that is being translated is parakaleo. The word para is the word that we get parallel from. And kaleo simply means to call. So in other words, Paul is calling the church alongside. He's literally saying, will you come sit down and have a conversation with me about unity? I think it's very fitting because that's exactly what we are doing this morning. We're saying, church family, unity's paramount. Come sit down. Let's talk about it. So what's going on in the church in Corinth? Well, let's break it down this way. Here's how one commentary put it. It says the Corinthian church was divided into at least four factions, each of them having its own emphasis and following its own leader and acting in antagonism to the other three. How frequently local church congregations, even denominations, are likewise divided into cliques. At Corinth, the four groups centered around four prominent leaders. The first was those who claimed to be adherents of Paul, possibly because he emphasized ministry to the Gentiles, a ministry which related really personally to a lot of them. The second said that they were followers of Apollos, and maybe they were enamored by Apollos' words. He was a very eloquent preacher, which is why, as Paul writes this letter, he says, I didn't come with eloquent words. It's not about the words. It's not about me. It's not about the words. another group of people, they were followers of Cephas, and basically that's the Aramaic name for the Apostle Peter. So if you see Cephas, that's Peter that we're talking about. And they were probably, no doubt, impressed with the Apostle Peter's emphasis on the Jews. Possibly they connected with him and connected with him as a Judaizer. And then the last group, they mentioned Christ, which we think is a good thing, but Paul doesn't exactly set it up that way. They mentioned the Christ party, suggesting that some in Corinth claim to have a special relationship with Christ, as in my relationship with Christ is better than your relationship with Christ. Paul's like, no, there's not room for any of that here. Christ isn't divided. The church isn't supposed to be divided. Christ prioritized unity in the church. Church, we must prioritize unity in the church. So Paul is challenging all four groups. And this morning I want to say he's challenging us. He's saying, is Christ divided? And the answer, of course, is no. Christ is not divided. It's simply not a rhetorical question, but it's a call to self-examination, a call to repentance for our part in enabling or promoting any kind of divisive spirit in the church whatsoever. It's a call to renew our commitment to Christ and unity as the body of Christ, particularly here where we are called to love each other, to worship together, to grow together in Christ, and to serve together to carry out the mission of Christ. So here's what I want to ask, since I said it's not a rhetorical question. Is there a divisive spirit in Clough Pike Baptist Church? The answer is yes and maybe. The yes is honestly more general. It's yes because we're all sinners. Even as we are redeemed by Christ, we tend to want things our own way. Anybody agree with that? We want things the way we want them, when we want them, how we want them. And when things don't go our own way, we can be prone to pout. We can be prone to grumble about the matter. Still, we fully realize the church is not about us. We fully realize that Christ is working in this church. Even if I don't like this going over here, we can see how Christ is working in it. See, the church isn't about our preferences. We're actually called to personally lay aside our preferences for the sake of the gospel. Jesus is supposed to be our rallying cry. So, yeah, there could be disunity in that sense. Yes. But the other answer was maybe. And I give this because this question or concern has potential to be divisive. And here's what I believe. I am asking this question because it was already asked. I want you to understand that. I'm asking this question because it was already asked. And I hope that as we address the question that maybe has the potential to be divisive, as we address the issue scripturally, theologically, historically, and personally, I'm going to give you my answer, that we will see our ability to not only be unified in Christ, unified in the gospel, unified in the vision and the values of Clough, but also that we are better able to thrive together and that we are better able to advance the kingdom of God if we're unified, even if we disagree. Does that make sense? Even if we disagree on certain things, we can be unified. See, I believe that's what Paul's heart was as he wrote to the church in Corinth, and I believe that's what God's heart is as we read scripture and talk together as Clough Pike Baptist Church this morning. So what was the question? Here it is. Recently the question was asked, where does Clough Pike stand on Reformed theology? If you don't know what that really means, I don't want you to worry about it because I'm going to explain it in just a minute. But here was my answer initially. My answer is that Clough is traditionally not a Reformed-leaning church, meaning that most of our church membership does not hold to Reformed theology. But here is what I want you to hear. It was most of our membership, because there is some of our membership that do hold to a Reformed theology. The follow-up question was this, is can those who do not hold to Reformed theology and those who do hold to Reformed theology, go to the same church, worship together, and serve together? And my answer to that is emphatically yes. I want you to know that we recently made a decision together as our staff, as our deacons, and as our ministry council. That's the leadership of our church. We came together, we had spent time in prayer, we talked about these questions with one another, and we were unanimous in the decision that simply said, of course we can work together, of course we can worship together, of course this is for the betterment of our church, of course this is for the advancement of the gospel. But let me go ahead and back up a minute or two and examine what exactly is Reformed theology, because I throw that out there and there's probably a good group of people that don't understand exactly what Reformed theology means. So when someone says they hold to Reformed theology, in general, they hold to what is known as the 5 points of Calvinism, or the tulip. And as I see it, what generally distinguished Reformed theology from more traditional Calvinistic theology is these 3 things: a true heart for personal evangelism, adherence to the practice of believers' baptism, as well as a more baptistic view of politics, meaning we believe in the separation of church and state, which traditional Calvinism does not. Here's what I want you to understand, just so you're not confused, right? That we believe that the church and state should be separated, but that in no way means that we as Christians do not advocate against immoral government positions such as abortion. I want to be clear on that. We can advocate against immoral positions and still believe in a separation of church and state. If you want to go into that a little bit deeper, I'm happy to do that with you, but we're just going to take a look for the next few minutes. What are the 5 points of Reformed theology? And so the acronym that is normally used is called TULIP, so we're going to use that, and we're going to talk about it a little bit deeper today. So the T in TULIP stands for this. It stands for total depravity. And this is the doctrine of original sin, which means this, that we are sinners, that we are not good, that we have no righteousness apart from God. As a matter of fact, Paul wrote in Romans 3:10-12, no one is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks God. All have turned aside together. They have become worthless. They do not do good, not even one. Here's what I want you to know. As Baptists, as Bible-believing Christians, we hold this truth. We are sinners. We're separated from a holy God by our sin. There's absolutely nothing we can do to make ourselves right with God. We must totally rely on God's grace towards sinners, which is offered through faith in Christ, who lived the perfect life that we couldn't live, died the death on the cross that we deserved 2,000 years ago on Calvary, and God took our sin and placed it on Jesus. And when Jesus rose from the grave 3 days later, that those who repent of their sin, those who trust in Jesus, will be saved. That's it. We're sinners. And we're saved by God. We're separated from God by our sin unless we are one with Christ. That's what total depravity means. We all agree with that. The U stands for this. It stands for unconditional election. Basically, if you do not hold to a Reformed position, sometimes that word election can rub us the wrong way. It can be a little bit scary. Listen, it's a biblical word. It's in the Bible. And this is what unconditional election simply means. It means that God extends his grace to us, not based on our goodness. We already covered that. We're not good. God extends his grace to us, not based on our virtuous quality, not based on our own ability, not based on something we have, but simply out of his own love for us. Do y'all agree with that? I agree with that. It's quite simple. There's nothing good in me. God gives me grace because he wants to, because of Jesus, not because of Josh. Here's what Ephesians 2:8-9 says. It says, for by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. In other words, it's not of anything you've done. It's not of anything you're going to do. It's a gift from God, not a result of works, so that no one can boast. So here's what unconditional election means. Our salvation is not about how good we are. It's not about what we can do for God. It's about what God has done for us, so that God gets all the glory. as he extends his goodness and grace to sinners like us. So that's the T, the U, the L. The L stands for this, limited atonement. Essentially, we all believe that while Jesus' death on the cross was sufficient to save the world, John 3:16 makes this perfectly clear, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son. God so loved the world. Jesus' death on the cross was sufficient to save the world. However, it is limited to those who believe. Here's what Jesus says, or what John says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that whosoever, the ones who do, the ones who will believe, will not perish but have eternal life. Here's what I want you to understand. So far, we're in complete agreement that when Jesus says that, or when the Bible says that we have to believe in Jesus to be saved, when Jesus himself says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, nobody comes to the Father but through me, there's no other way, that salvation is limited to those who trust in Jesus. So faith in Jesus is the only way. Peter in Acts chapter 2, 12 tells the crowd this, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name on heaven given among men which by we must be saved. Here's the thing, apart from Christ, there's no salvation. That's all that is saying. Now here's the next one, it's the I. This is probably where most of us are going to find disagreements. Or this is potentially where some of us could find disagreements. The I stands for irresistible grace. What this means is that whom God chooses, he calls, and through the work of the Spirit, God saves prior to any response, but then prompting the response of repentance and belief. Therefore, according to this view, God's grace never fails, it's never thwarted, and it's never rejected. All whom God chooses to save, God saves. Scripture, which is used to support this perspective, includes 1 Corinthians 12:3, which reads, therefore, I want you to understand that no one is speaking in the Holy Spirit of God. No one speaking ever says Jesus is accursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Spirit. And John 6:44 reads this, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. Here's what I'm going to say, because I realize this is confusing. I'm going to share my perspective on these verses in just a little bit. But I want to share with you what this means in full before we look at it historically. And then, like I said, I will give you my personal response to this. Because even if we disagree, I also really want you to see that there is room here at Clough to be united around the purposes of God, the mission of God, and who God's called Clough to be. So here's number five. Finally, we get to the P, which does not stand for predestination. Rather, it stands for this, perseverance of the saints. Some call this doctrine security of the believer, or it might be heard, you might have heard, once saved, always saved. And here's what it means. It means that those who are saved by God's grace cannot then lose salvation either by sin or by bad works. The Bible says in Ephesians 1:13 and 14, in him, you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, you were sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. And John 10:28 says this, I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. And on this point, we once again say we're in agreement. In other words, that when we trust in Christ, there's nothing we can do to remove ourselves from the grace of God. We all agree with that. And by the way, none of us would want that to not be true, because if it were not true, then guess what? We're all going to fail. So here's what I want to share. First and foremost, we are in far greater agreement on these things than we are in disagreement. It's also worth noting that to not be reformed does not mean that you are Arminian in theology. As Baptists, we're certainly not Arminian, because we reject that what Arminian says, that we are fallen, but we are still kind of good. And that's a general Arminian understanding, but we already covered what it says in Romans. There's none good, there's none who seek me. None means none, all right? but Arminian theology generally says, well, you are fallen, but you can still choose to be good, sort of. The heart, Jeremiah 17 kind of clarifies this when it says the heart is desperately wicked. And Isaiah says it this way, that the best we have to offer God is filthy rags. We are not good. So what else about Arminian theology? Arminian theology also says we can lose our salvation, which we've already clearly said you can't do that. So you may not be Reformed, but we also need to know we're not Arminian. And you might be asking this morning, well, what exactly am I? And that, I want to say, I'm glad you asked. Personally, I think you're Baptist, and that's okay. All right? So those are the definitions. We got them under our belt. I want you to briefly consider Baptist history, and this is important. It really is important. We're going to look at Baptist history, and we're going to also look at who we are as Southern Baptist as a whole, because, you know, Southern Baptist, we're Protestant. We came from the Reformation, the Protestant Reformation, just as denominations like Methodist and Presbyterian and others came from the Protestant Reformation. And in Europe, especially in England, Baptists were divided into two different groups. The first group were called particular Baptists, and they believed that God saved particularly. In other words, they were Reformed-leaning Baptists. Now, there was another group, and they were called the General Baptists, and they believed that God saved generally. And that's kind of your non-Reformed Baptist-leaning group. But then in America, what ends up happening is you have a guy who comes to America by the name of Roger Williams, and he breaks from the Church of England, and he starts the first Baptist church in America in Rhode Island. And now by the early 1700s, there's also the Philadelphia Baptist Association, which comes together. However, what you need to know when Baptists come to America, that the distinctions between general Baptist and particular Baptist seem to have been greatly diminished. And we were just all together. So what about Southern Baptist? Well, what you need to know is that we are a part of the Southern Baptist Convention. I believe this is a really good thing. By the way, if you don't know much about Southern Baptist, we are the largest Protestant denomination in the world with almost 50,000 churches worldwide. We have the largest mission-sending organization in the world. When you give to Clough, you are giving to support missions going out all around the world. We also have the largest refugee ministry and one of the largest disaster relief ministries. So being Southern Baptist is pretty cool, if you ask me. But what does that have to do with this? Well, the SBC officially formed in 1845 around the purpose of missions. The Baptist Faith and Message, which is our conventions, as well as Clough Pike's official statement of faith, can be found on our website, or you can Google Baptist Faith and Message if you want to look it up and find it in other places. But here's what it says about this issue. We're going to look at two parts of it, two articles as they're called. The first one is salvation, and this is what it says. Salvation involves the redemption of the whole man and is offered freely to all who accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, who by his own blood obtained eternal redemption for the believer. In the broadest sense, salvation includes regeneration, justification, sanctification, and glorification, and there is no salvation apart from a personal faith in Jesus Christ as Lord. The next article talks about God's purpose of grace. It's Article 5, and this is what it says. Election is the gracious purpose of God, according to which he regenerates, justifies, sanctifies, and glorifies sinners. It is consistent with the free agency of man and comprehends all the meaning in connection with the end. It is the glorious display of God's sovereign goodness, and it's infinitely wise, holy, and unchangeable. It excludes boasting and promotes humility. All true believers endure to the end. Those whom God has accepted in Christ and sanctified by his Spirit will never fall away from the state of grace, but shall persevere to the end. Believers may fall into sin through neglect and temptation, whereby they grieve the Spirit, impair their graces and comforts, and bringing reproach on the cause of Christ and temporal judgments on themselves. Yet they shall be kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. here's what I want you to hear, because that is a word, that is a mouthful even just to say. I want you to hear what this means. And I'm going to tell you what I have always heard. I'm going to tell you what I've heard in seminary, and I'm going to tell you what I've heard from the platform of the National Convention. The sentiment is this: for those who are Reformed and for those who are non-Reformed alike. The Baptist Faith and Message, I've already said, this is the doctrinal statement of our convention and of our church, was intentionally left open in the area where, in this area, whereas those who are Reformed and those who are not can both be welcomed under the banner of Southern Baptist, can serve alongside each other, and can carry out the Great Commission together. Here is what you ought to be hearing. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, and we are brothers and sisters in mission. So here is my personal take. I've shared it with multiple people over the years, and I'm going to share it. You don't have to agree with me, and I want you to know that's okay. My wife disagrees with me sometimes, and we still get along, all right? So you don't have to agree with me on this, and that's okay. Here's my take. When the Bible talks about the sovereignty of God and that no one can come to faith in Jesus unless the Father draws, I simply teach and lift up this truth, that we worship and serve a sovereign God who created all, knows all, is all-powerful, controls all, and is above all to such an extent that my feeble mind can't understand it all. If I could, I'd be God, and that's clearly not the case. Moreover, the fact that such a God who is completely holy and righteous would choose in any way to redeem a sinner such as myself is absolutely beyond me. And so I can only say praise God. On the other hand, when the Bible talks about whosoever will may come, I simply teach and lift up this truth as well, that God extends his grace, grace that is unearned, and yet grace that we are able to receive through faith because of the work of Christ as we repent and turn to Jesus. Ultimately, here's where I stand as a pastor. I'm kind of a both and guy. It seems to me as I read the scriptures and all of scripture that God must call and man must still respond. I see it very much like a marriage proposal. See, one evening in Charleston, I got down on one knee, I pulled a ring out of my pocket, I opened it up, and I said, "Mandy, will you marry me?" She still had to say yes. I see God drawing, and I see man responding in a similar way. I think about my own salvation. I think about that 2,000 years ago, Jesus died on the cross for me. And one evening when I was in eighth grade, I heard about my own sinfulness and God's great love for me. And God extended grace to me as I repented of my sin and placed my faith in Jesus. And here's what I can say, how it happened, what order it happened, I don't know. But that it happened, that I was once dead and now I'm alive in Christ, I know full well. And that's the truth to which every believer throughout all generations ought to say amen. So today, you might disagree with me. That's okay. You might disagree with somebody sitting next to you. That's okay. On this, we can still love one another. On this, we can still work together towards our common goals. You might even disagree about other things. And I would tell you, that's okay. The great Baptist preacher C.H. Spurgeon, or Charles Spurgeon, says it this way. The fact is that the great question about man's responsibility, free will, and predestination have been fought over and over and over again and have been answered in 10,000 different ways. And the results have been that we know it just as much about the matter as when we first began. The combatants have thrown dust into each other's eyes and have hindered each other from seeing. And then they have concluded that because the other person can't see, they therefore can see. Church, there's no room for dust flinging. By the way, if we're throwing dust in each other's eyes, you know what we're not going to do? We're not going to be accomplishing the mission that God has given us. if we're throwing dust in each other's eyes, we're not going to be sharing the gospel with people who need to hear the life-transforming message of Jesus Christ, that Jesus died on the cross to save them from their sins if they will repent and believe the gospel. See, here is what I want you to understand. We need to know that we can disagree about certain things without breaking fellowship. We can disagree without belittling. We can disagree without being hateful or without being haughty. Are there things that we must agree on? Absolutely. We must not disagree that the Bible is the inerrant word of God and means what it says. We must not disagree that Jesus is still saving sinners like you and me. We must not disagree that people are lost, dying, and going to hell and need to hear the good news that Jesus loves them and died for them and is willing to save them. We must not disagree that we need unity because Jesus didn't simply suggest that we like each other, but that he prayed and commanded that we be one as he and the Father are one. Go back to our passage. Paul says, I appeal to you. Come alongside me, church family. I appeal to you. Brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree and that there may be no divisions among you. That doesn't mean there's not differences of opinions. The fact that Paul was writing this didn't mean that they were all going to say, well, you know what, I'm wrong and you're right and we're going to come, you know, I'm just going to accept it. That didn't mean that there weren't differences of opinions, but rather we were agreeing on the primary things. We were agreeing on the gospel of Jesus. We are coming together in unity around the gospel of Christ. We are agreeing in the priority of unity, and we're agreeing in the mission that the church has been given by Jesus as he was raised from the dead and said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. Yeah, we need to agree on these things. So here's what we're going to do. I realize it's a big ask, but I believe we are going to do this morning. And I believe it's absolutely critical. See, if you are a member of Clough Pike, you have a responsibility this morning to decide for unity. That doesn't mean you have to agree, but rather you have to decide for unity. So I'm calling everyone, every leader, every member, to join me at the altar this morning in prayer, that we would pray for one another, that we would pray for unity, and that we would pray for God to move in us and through us, that those who are lost would hear and respond to the gospel. If you're a member of Clough at this time, I want you to know the time to come to the altar is now. And as a matter of fact, this is so important that Aaron's not coming up on stage. I'm coming down. And we're just going to gather together and spend a few moments in prayer. And after a few moments pass, I will close us. If you'll go ahead and start some music, we're going to spend some time together in prayer this morning.
Are you hurt? Have you come to the end of yourself?
Father and our God, we come to you this morning and we have trudged through some deep waters. God, they're waters that some of us didn't even know were deep, didn't even know about. They're waters that some of us have very strong opinions about. God, our goal this morning was not to change minds on this issue. Our goal this morning was simply to say, even in our disagreement around this issue, we're going to be unified. We're going to be unified as a church because we know that your word is true, because we know that Jesus saves. We know that lost people still need to hear the gospel. We know that you've called us to be on mission, and God, to break fellowship, to harbor grudge, to be haughty, there's just no time and there's no place for that. God, we might disagree about something that can and has been in the past divisive. God, we are asking for the leading of your Spirit. We are asking for the comfort of grace. We are asking for that you would give us love for one another, because we realize your word says love covers a multitude of sins. It can cover disagreements like this. Now we simply pray, help us to be unified. Lord, the priority of unity is so great because the priority of the mission is so great. Help us to be unified, that people would see you in us. Lord, we don't have it all, but what we know is there's no more time, there's no more room for throwing dust in one another's eyes. But as I look out upon the crowd, I pray that you would just work in these families. There's so many up around this altar this morning. God, thank you for that. Thank you for the blessing of unity. Work in our lives, how we can be excited about what you're doing. Work in our lives, work in our church, how we can go forward and accomplish your mission. Be with us now as always, Jesus. We love you. We love one another. And we thank you. And we thank you for one another. It's in Jesus' name we pray.